Thank you for introduction. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here to share my experience with you. I hope that at the end of my talk, you will be familiar with the pharmacovigilance system in Thailand and also know how pharmacovigilance and pharmacogenomics work together. I have divided my presentation in three parts. The first is the overview of the Thai pharmacovigilance system. The second is the Thai vigilance base, it's a pharmacovigilance database. And the third part is the pharmacovigilance and the pharmacogenomic research. For the overview of the Thai pharmacovigilance system, I classify it into levels. The first level is the national level, the pharmacovigilance network and management. Classified into level. One is the national level, and the second is the hospital level. And another part is the surveillance methods utilized in the pharmacovigilance. We do both passive and active method. Let me introduce a little bit about Thailand. Thailand is a country in the Southeast Asia with the population of 65 million people divided in the 77 provinces. Pharmacovigilance was activated in 1983 and the National Center was set up as a part of the Thai FDA at the same year. The year later, Thailand joined the WHO program International for Drug Monitoring as the 26th member in 1984. Right now, I think it's about 100 countries. This slide shows our network and the management at the national level. Someone called it the macro pharmacovigilance. Hospital is our main source of report. About 1,000 to 1,500 setting report to our center each year. Their report as voluntary, not mandatory, but anyway, most of them is a government hospital and the government has the policy for them to report to us. For the company or marketing authority, it's mandatory for just only the new drug in accordance to the safety monitoring program. And all the database will be analyzed. If the signal is detected, it will proceed to consider the pharmacovigilance especially committee to consider whether any measure should be minimized measure should be implemented. For the communication measure, we can do immediately, but for the regulatory measure, we have to get the adoption from the drug committee. Then Thai FDA will do the enforcement for that regulation. The AE online reporting system is the main system that the hospital used to report to us. Anyway, the other methods are welcome, such as email, fax, and mail, post-paid mail. Every month, we will send back the letter to acknowledgement and to inform how many reports that we receive from each hospital or each company and inform how the quality that they send to us. Each report will be classified by the quality of the completeness of the report. And for the routine, we will have a drug bulletin. And also, each year, we will do the annual report. And in some situations, some alert will be feedback to the reporter. This is a safety monitoring. It's a condition for the new drug application only. So during 2 years, this program will be conducted for 2 years. During these 2 years, the company have to do the ADR monitoring. So they send us the report. for the individual report, they have to send up according to the timeline, but every 4 months they have to summarize and send the summary to us. Now let's move to the hospital level. In the hospital, pharmacy played a major role in this activity. When there is a ADN diagnosis, pharmacy will be notified to collect the data and do the assessment. Physicians in Thailand don't want to fill in any report, so pharmacy take care of this job. And after they do a causality assessment, they will feedback the result to the physician. Sometimes they have a discussion whether agree with the result or not. At the same time, pharmacy will send the report to our center and try to minimize the risk by several methods. For example, they will provide the dark alert card to the patient. This card will document the suspected drug name, adverse drug reaction, and causality assessment level, and also the reporter, and recommend the patient how to use this card, because it's very hard for the patient to remember the name, which is all English name. So we recommend them have to take this card every time when they see the doctor. At the sometime when the pharmacist will do the consult, to do the patient consultation to the patient who receive the medicine that can induce the severe cutaneous adverse drug reaction. This is the book for them. And this slide shows several many methods that we use to try to minimize the risk. This is the sticker to inform that this patient develop adverse drug reaction, this patient charge, medical record, and of course also patient bed. Some of you may have a question why we add on so many pages, because we would like to convey this message to the one who should know about that. And the information about it also input in the dispensing program to alert when the doctor prescribes the same medicine with the same patient who experienced about the adverse drug reaction. Then the pharmacist will call back to confirm whether the doctor still would like to prescribe that medicine or not. The causality assessment method that the pharmacist used is the same as the US FDA, the WHO, Uppsala monitoring method, and also Nalanjo algorithm, and also the Thai algorithm. The Thai algorithm is modified from the WHO UMC. For the surveillance method that we use, we use both passive and active method. For the passive methods, spontaneous reporting is the main method that for all drugs. And for the targeted spontaneous reporting is for some safety concern, for some drug of interest. For example, is conditional approval new drug or herbal medicine used which in the national essential drug list, and the medicine used in the public health program, such as anti-TB drug or ARV. For the active surveillance, the intensive hospital monitoring will be conducted for some product only. And I hope that this year or next year, the cohort event monitoring will be implemented for the anti-TB, for the new drug of anti-TB. And for the registry, we conducted only one project, is a Thai Ebola registry, because Thailand have a problem that the incident of the pleural aphasia associated with the erythropoietin is higher than the other country in the world. For the Thai vigilance, I will classify as shown on the slide. This slide shows the characteristic of our database. Right now, about 6 million reports were accumulated. Over half of them have been received in the last 6 years. About 50,000 reports we receive each year. Only 2.1% of the report were submitted by the company. Most of them come from the hospital. And about 20% of serious cases were received. During 1984 to 2014, 18,000 reports were received. We can classify its HHS as about is the most adverse drug reaction that we receive. For the epidermal necrolysis is the preferred term of the toxic epidermal necrolysis. We use the WHO who are different from the MEDA. Similar but not the same. But the classification is the same. This slide shows the Steven Johnson syndrome. The total SJS and 10 report is 11,000 right now. The proportion of this report in Thai Wichibet is about 1.8. This is the characteristic of the report. About half of them rank at the probable level, and 2% of them have a death outcome. This slide shows the most suspected drug associated with SJS and 10. I think it's similar to the US FDA. And this slide shows the signal that our report contribute in the WHO database to generate signal. Two of them is Steven Johnson, this PTU. The number, this is five report is come from Thailand, from 12. And this is the signal generation that do by our Thai FDA. We found the streptomycin associated with the Steven Johnson syndrome in 2013. This slide shows the report in our database consistent with the publication from Africa that indicated that an increasing risk of the severe cutaneous reaction associated with the use of the thioacetazone in person who with HIV. So at the same time, our data can detect the signal. Even though the report didn't mention that this patient is a HIV patient or not, but at the same time that the HIV epidemic in Thailand, this is public in the WHO bulletin. For the research and publication that using our database, this is the our colleagues TC, we evaluate reporting serious adverse drug reaction in Thailand, a case study of HJS and 10. The study is a cross-sectional study. We select 14 selected hospitals from five regions of Thailand. We compare the report that our center received in 2005 compared with the report, how can I say, the ICD-10 compared to the report from this hospital. We retrieved the case by using the ICD-10 computerized system and then verify with the patient medical record. The results show that the under report is about 44%. And this condensed submission is about 8%. This slide shows the publication that using our database, both of them. And now let's move to the last part. This picture shows our campus. And this one, even if I am not here, but from the Dr. Watson picture, confirmed that I was there. And from the brainstorming, we found that the association between the carbamazepine induced SJS and 10 confirmed. And we estimated that if we about 90% can be prevented by screening tests. So from the brainstorming, there are several events come out. One is the proposal for the universal screen for carbamazepine, and they need the economic study, and also they need to develop the pharmacogenomic testing center. And at the same time, the pharmacogenomic network has been conducted. From the result, the testing for the neuropathic pain is called effective, but not for the epilepsy. Epilepsy is a borderline. And this is a nice center of the pharmacogenomic testing. And 3-day quarantine turn allow time for this service. And this slide shows the first announcement for the nationwide pharmacogenomic service. And the pilot free testing for the all carbamazepine prescribed in Bangkok. And for the study, 18 hospitals, which is our pharmacovigilance network, participate in the Thai SCAR pharmacogenomic phase 1 study. And this slide shows how our center participate in this study. It's every week, one of my colleagues will detect the case and then inform the researcher, Dr. Sulakamet. And this slide shows the number of DNA samples collected based on the suspected drug. And I show this slide again because someone may think that because of carbamazepine testing reduce the case, but I think we have to find out the further research have to conduct. I will end my talk with this slide. The collaborating between the pharmacovigilance team and pharmacogenomic team, not just only benefit each other. For my opinion, I think it's benefit for the patient safety as well. Thank you for attention. And thank you, Dr. Sulakamet, for preparing the third part.
Great. Thank you very much. Yes, Dr. Leader.
That was very interesting. I noticed on a couple of slides, one in the reported cases, that the number of reported cases of cotrimoxazole, trimethoprim sulfa, was exceeded considerably that of carbamazepine. And also in your collected DNA samples, you had a lot of cotrimoxazole samples. Do you think that's a function of an increased susceptibility in the Thai population, or does that reflect a use that's greater than what we might use in North America or Europe?
I pass this to Dr. Sulakamet.
I think there are several factors. First, we use a lot of sulfamethoxazole because we have HIV epidemic. And this drug is used for opportunistic prophylaxis. before we have a national antiretroviral program. So we have a lot of cases 5-10 years ago, because Bactrim or Pharmacovigilance is recommended for the one who cannot afford the antiretroviral. So at that time, we use a lot. So we have a lot of cases with adverse drug reactions. And the second is that Pharmacovigilance is the highly suspected drugs. When we treat the HIV-infected patient, we usually give them or give them multiple drugs. And then if you have multiple drugs and the pharmacist or the physician has to pick the causative drugs, then it will be the highly suspected. So it's become the first one. So every time anyone reported, it become the first one that pick it to be the suspected drug. So that's the second. And the third one, we found some association with HOA class 1 with this pharmacovigilance in Thai population. And we are trying to publish the data. And probably we have some specific association with some HOA and Liu. So maybe these are the explaining factors.
But it's the combination of sulfamethoxazole and trimethoprim that you're giving, or
it's a combination.
It is a combination.
Yes.
Is there much use of trimethoprim alone?
Oh, we rarely use it. We usually use them together.
I'm sorry.
I confirm that when pharmacists always think the sulfa medicine is the suspected that for the Steven Johnson and Tin. So the comethoxazole always the suspected that for that report.
I wonder if maybe Dr. Sirakameth or others could comment on the interaction between Stevens-Johnson and HIV-AIDS, in that it seems that patients with AIDS are at like, you know, 1,000-fold increased risk or so, particularly when their CD4 counts are low. Do you want to comment on that?
So we have also the nevirapine, which is the another drugs that cause Steven tens in our populations. And yes, we observe that Steven 10 has a lot higher risk in HIV population, but we do not know exactly why. So maybe it's a topic that we can study.
Yes, Dr. Malkin.
We used to see substantial number of cases related to nevirapine, especially in France. And we had some suspect that at some point maybe patients of African origin may be more susceptible. We could not really prove that, but these were people living in the greater area of Paris, where you have a higher population deriving from these countries in Africa. But ever since there's other alternatives, we hardly see cases after nevirapine in Europe, in Central Europe. Our colleagues from South Africa report a completely different picture. The majority, this is, let's say, a governmental hospital run by the government, so everyone comes there, the poor people as well. Most of them are HIV infected plus have tuberculosis. So that means they have 6-7 drugs, three or four for each of the conditions. And it's very difficult to identify the culprit one, because they are kind of started pretty much at the same time. And they have developed a certain protocol how to deal with it. Because sometimes it's not easy to say whether it is one of the anti-TB drugs or of the HIV drugs. So they stop everything and then step by step reintroduce the drugs, because otherwise they would risk the germs would be not sensitive to any medication anymore. So these are probably the people who could talk about this best, but of course none is here right now.
So in our prospective cohort study in Malawi, we followed 1,000 patients from initiation of virapine for at least 6 months afterwards. At that time, the policies were not to start antituberculous therapy at the same time. So these patients were started on triple therapy in terms of nevirapine, zidovudine, and stavidine at that time. So that the because of the high risk of these hypersensitivity syndromes, the Malawian ministry, National Health Ministry, has changed the drugs. Now efavirenz is the commonly used drug, and stavidine is also gone because of peripheral neuropathy. But when we have done the work, and this is also seen in Northern European populations, the actual risk factor in terms of CD4 count is that you have to have a high CD4 count greater than 250 to be able to get the Steven Johnson syndrome. I guess the pathogenetic point of view from that is that if you have too low a CD4 count, you don't actually have the immune system to be able to generate an immune response to start killing you off your skin cells.
Just to follow on that, there is some data that also suggests with nevirapine, there's three or four separate studies that suggest in patients that are switching with undetectable HIV viral load that they don't get the reaction. So if they're virologically suppressed, their HIV is controlled, they don't seem to be at higher risk regardless of their CD4 count. So I think that's interesting. I just had a second question just regarding geography of Thailand. And the diversity within it. I know northern Thailand has a lot more higher prevalence of specific Caucasian HLA alleles like HLA-B5701. Do you see any signals across the country in terms of actually differences, potentially in terms of reporting of specific drug reactions based on that diversity?
I'm not sure I get your questions, but is this about the geographical distribution?
Yeah, northern Thailand has different HLA representation, like certain HLA-B alleles, like HLA-B5701, the carriage rate there would be as high as 10%, just like in Europeans.
We did the determination of the regional distribution of HLA-B specifically, and 1501 has a northern-southern gradation. But it's not so large difference. Like in the northern, we have like a 6% or something, and then in the southern, we have 10%. So, but that's it. Only frequency. So, if it's a carrier, it turned out to be 12 to 20, ranging from the northern to the southern. But the southern has higher rate of, prevalence of 1502.
Right.
But for the 3505. It's about 3% distributed all over the country. There's no specific difference in the region, but the Indonesian population has a lot higher 35 or 5 percentage.
But then I think the question is, do you see a geographic influence of rates? I mean, I guess the numbers may be too low to see, but do you see different rates of SGS-10?
We don't see that, I think.
What actually happens with regards to like healthcare in Thailand, where patients access care as opposed to where they're from?
There were two maps that we represent, and the first one is NICE Center for pharmacogenomic testing, and the other one is the 18 hospitals that participating in collecting DNA samples for this Steven Tan's case. So that 18 hospitals is the voluntary working with us. So they are the hospital that has adverse drug reaction pharmacist. So these pharmacists are interested in Steven Tan's more than the others. So they work with the patients and they get the sample for us to test in the research.
Thanks.
And another thing is most of this hospital is tertiary hospital. So the Steven Johnson case always refer to this hospital.
Dr. Wimon, could you go back to the slide, your Vichy base? The one that did. The one that from 2010 and then dropping the Stephen Johnson and 10 cases.
This one? this one?
Because one of our objective is to try to eradicate Stephen Johnson and 10. So in Thailand, can I say that now we are approaching that mode of eradication? And my question is, what is the cause of dropping of Stephen Johnson and 10? Because of the pharmacogenomic screening or because of the pharmacists in the hospital?
Let me show another piece. It's not just only the Stephen Johnson case drop. It's the total, this one, okay. This one also drop. But anyway, I just see the proportion of the Stephen Johnson's and 10 case is the same proportion as during we conduct the study from 2012. It's about 1.6 to 1.7. It's still the same. And I think it's not just only the testing. At the hospital, it's a policy that the pharmacist have to reduce the Stevens Johnson case as much as they can. So whenever the doctor prescribes the drug that can induce the Stevens Johnson, they will give the counseling to the patient, prodrome of the Stevens Johnson, and ask the patient come as fast as they can to stop the drug. So I think this might be one factor that decrease the case. And the other one might be the testing. So I think we have to conduct the research to find out what is the real factor.
So in Thailand, it's quite interesting that in provinces, pharmacists is more powerful than clinicians. They have more say in Stephen and how to prescribe the medication. But in Bangkok, doctors have a final say, not the pharmacist. Somehow that is debatable. We could find out the way. Huh? But anyhow, somehow the Stephen Johnson and they're dropping.
Because for the drug safety, it sounds like the pharmacist's role to reduce the risk of the drug.